Last year, we published several videos on the NCS5500 internal resources. It's now time to talk about packet buffering and quality of service. Yes, you heard it right, QOS. But before covering the subtleties of the QOS implementation, it's important to explain how the packets are processed in the NCS5500 and how the buffering is actually working. More after the intro. In early 2019, the NCS5500s are powered by Broadcom DNX ASICs, Qumran MX, Jericho, and Jericho Plus. They are based on the same architecture, and all the concepts detailed in these videos will apply to all of them. So we will use the term NPUs or forwarding ASICs from now on. Let's start by comparing the high-level design of the NCS5500s to other IOSXR platforms, like the CRS or the ASR9K. One of the first differences between them is relative to the destination lookup process. On ASR9K or CRS, we have a two-step lookup model where the first stage happens in ingress and determine what is the destination line card, and more precisely, where is the destination NPU on this line card. The packet goes through the fabric, is split and reassembled, and reaches the egress NPU where a second lookup takes place. This time, it will figure out the egress interface, the MAC address, etc. On the NCS5500, we just have one single lookup happening in the ingress NPU. The idea is to cut in half the resources and memory accesses. The benefits are a reduced latency, a lower power consumption, and eventually a lower OPEX and CAPEX. Let's get back to our two-step model. When a packet is forwarded, it will be stored in ingress memory first, and then in a large egress buffer. In this case, no congestion. The packet doesn't stay long and is sent to the destination next-stop router. If the egress port is congested, packets are received and stored in the egress buffer. At some point, we don't have enough room or enough resource, and the egress NPU will be forced to signal to the ingress side that it can't receive more packets, and they need to be discarded in the ingress to stop wasting fabric bandwidth. Now, once the congestion disappears, we will use a QOS configuration to decide which queues should be emptied first. If no QOS is configured, it will be first in, first out. This architecture, with some small variations, has been used to design routers for two decades. It works well, but it is also expensive, at least in terms of power consumption. The NCS5500 is using a VOQ-only model with ingress buffering. It will rely on the constant communication between the ingress and egress pipelines of all the router NPUs. The packet is received and stored in the ingress buffer. Lookup is performed and the NPU identifies where is the destination. The ingress scheduler will now ask the permission to transmit to the egress side. It's only after receiving the write that the packet is sent to the egress NPU and is transmitted to the next hop router. Now, let's imagine the destination queue is saturated. Note that it could be a port or just a queue, but we'll come back on these concepts later. For each packet received, the ingress scheduler will contact its egress counterpart, and since the permission to transmit is not granted, the packet will pile up in the ingress buffer, building up a queue. As soon as the congestion situation disappears, the QOS configuration will be translated into scheduler decision. In this example, the red packet in priority queue will be transmitted first, and then the other queues will be emptied following the percentages defined in the policy. If you paid attention to the last diagrams, we represented the ingress buffer being both inside and outside our NPU. Indeed, the NCS5500 uses a model called hybrid buffering. But what does it mean? For each NPU, we have three types of packet memories. In ingress, we have 16 megabytes inside the ASIC. We talk about on-chip buffer or OCB. Also, in ingress, we have a 4 gigabyte graphical memory on the side of the chipset. We call it off-chip buffer or more generally DRAM. Finally, on the egress side, we also have a 16 megabyte memory named egress port buffer. If the queue contains less than 6,000 packets, or 200,000 bytes, the packets are stored in on-chip buffer. It's only when we exceed this threshold that we evict the queue to the DRAM. We will see in the second part that it represents actually a tiny portion of the total traffic. And for the vast majority of the cases, it will be much less than 1%. Don't forget that this mechanism is happening at the queue level. We'll only evict a couple of queues to DRAM, while all others will stay on in OCB. That's a typical case of a large burst. and once a queue is emptied, it will move back to the OCB. On the egress side, we also have a 16 megabyte port buffer. And for every egress interface, we have only four queues: unicast, multicast, high and low priority for each. The buffering here is meant to be minimal. When we will talk about multicast in a future video, we'll come back on the way it uses specifically this egress memory. So we talk about queues and virtual output queues, but what is it exactly? We can allocate 8 queues per egress point. That includes layer 2 or layer 3 interface, subinterface, bundles, etc. But these queues will not exist on the egress part of the NPU where are located the output interfaces. Remember, we are doing ingress buffering. That means for each exit interface, we create a virtual representation of the output queue. But in reality, it will only exist in the ingress NPUs. And I should say in all the ingress NPUs. For example, with the interface 100GB0700.2, the queues are present in line card 0 NPU 0, line card 0 NPU 1, and line card 7 NPU 0. And that will be the same for every output port, like 100GB0701 or 100GB0101. We are often asked the question, how many queues does the NPU support? Each ingress NPU supports 96,000 queues, but we actually use around 80,000 flow connectors. The number of queues used is the total number of logical ports multiplied by 8, and they are duplicated on all the ingress NPUs. Let's try to show it differently, at the router level this time. We have a line card in slot 7, and we consider the interface 100GB0700.2. Here are the virtual queues associated to this logical port. But if we have an ingress interface in slot 0, the queues for this output port 0700.2 are physically present in the NPU in line card 0. And same if we have another ingress port connected to line card 1. In fact, the same logic applies if the ingress port is located on the same NPU than the output interface. For example, 100.0701. The queues are located on the ingress port here too. In essence, it's what you have when you operate a single ASIC router, like the NCS5501 or the NCS5582 modular. We still have the communication between the ingress part of the pipeline and the egress part to agree on packet transmission. From the ingress NPU, we can take a look at the numbers of packets and bytes transmitted to any egress interface. In this example, I'm checking the VOQ stats for the interface 0701 and from the perspective of the NPU 0, line card 7. Depending on the queue utilization, we can have packets stored in OCB or DRAM in ingress. Now comes the question of the speed to access this DRAM resource. In this generation of products, the link between the NPU and the DRAM is 900GB unidirectional. That means we can write in DRAM at 700GB and read at 200GB simultaneously, or read at 600 and write at 300 at the same time. It's designed to handle bursts of traffic. In the worst case, if you maintained a sustained condition of traffic evicted to the DRAM, you will end up with 450GB read and 450GB write. The opponents of such architecture are trying to present this as a problem, but we will demonstrate in the next video that they are using nonsensical scenarios only valid in their lab, and we will prove it with real numbers coming from real live networks. In a chassis, the traffic targeted to a specific next-stop router will be received from multiple ingress interfaces. And since we are using ingress buffering, the more ingress interfaces we have, the more buffer memory and the more bandwidth the DRAM will be able to use. It's important to understand that the blockade on a queue will not impact the other queues. So we cannot have the problems of head-of-line blocking that we have seen in the past. Since every packet transmission is scheduled, having some ports congested will not impact the other ports or even the other queues. In this example, the first two packets are not given the right to be transmitted, but the packet in green will be authorized. Also, if we have a sustained saturation on a given queue, it will lead to packets being tail-dropped, but that does not affect the packet going to another queue, even on the same ingress port if the bandwidth is available. Of course, we have counters to monitor all these behaviors, and I will detail them in the next video. More technical details will be present in a blog post, and you will find the link in the description below. Thanks for watching, and click here for the second part of this series.